Are we doing indoors or outdoors today? What's the rationale? Okay. Shamar v'zachor. Tell me a little more about it, babe. Shabbat shalom, everyone. It's so good to be with you, and it's so good to be on the other side of Yom Kippur, and so good to be anticipating Sukkot together. I wanted to frame our class today by naming attention that I, at least, have never really talked about before, but this year it just really hit me, and that is the tension between where we are on the holiday calendar and where we are in our Torah reading calendar. So on the holiday calendar, it's a very happy trajectory. We go through the season of Judgment, Rosh Hashanah, Tshuva, Rosh Hashanah, Tshuva, Yom Kippur. But the idea is that, you know, if we do Teshuvah, and if we commit to our Teshuvah resolutions, Kitaru, we're purified, we're cleansed. And we're going to be inscribed and then sealed, we said on Elah, for another year. A year that's good and sweet and healthy. And a better version of ourselves. So it's a happy trajectory. And we mark that happiness by doing Sukkot, where it's the mind simchat and rejoice. Sit in your sukkah, or sleep in your sukkah, or have your wine, have your soup, be with your friends. It's a happy trajectory. That's on the one hand. On the other hand, the Torah reading cycle is kind of a downer, because we're reading about the end of Moses' life, and the trajectory is not happy and happy inscribed for another year. And the readings last week and this week are just particularly brutal. Last week, God says to Moses, your work has been a failure. And this week, God says to Moses, you're going to die on the wrong side of the River Jordan. And by the way, when the Israelites get there, they're going to mess it up. Again, your whole life work has been for naught. So the holiday trajectory is from serious to happy. Take your life seriously, and then you get happy. And the reading trajectory is pretty hard and sad. So I wanted to just kind of start this off with a hypo, where I get to be God, and I'm talking to you, Elias, and that, well, just to frame this before we, oh, and then, yes, we do have to do the brachot. We'll do the brachot, and then we'll get right into our hypo together. Baruch So I always think that Torah texts land best when we apply them to our own life. So you'll judge whether what I'm about to do is a fair rendering of the spirit of our first text from Vayera. But I think it is, but you'll judge that, and you're at home with that. But God says to Moses, you're about to die. That's the context, okay? And by the way, all of us who've been with people who are in their last days with their family, the move is to reassure them. You tell somebody, mom, it's going to be okay. Dad, it's going to be okay. And the kids around the bedside, papa, nana, mom, dad, it's going to be okay. The kids are going to be okay. Everything is going to be okay. We're good. We're in a good place. You're free to go. You've done your work, mom. You've done your work, dad. we're at peace. Okay? This is God's voice. So, Elias, I really like the door for door you've done all your years. I love your singing, your voice. I love when you do it with David. Love when you did it with Mikey. Love when you did it with all the teams at Temple 9. And all the services all those years for the door for door was beautiful. But Elias, just want you to know before you die that it didn't work. But all those years of barn buttons, the kids that you taught and tutored, they're just basically indifferent to doing. They don't get it and they don't care. And as a result, their lives are just impoverished. Because the Judaism that I had wanted you to teach them did not land. You're about to die. That, I believe, is a fair rendering of God's voice here. Okay? And my question is, but just before we get into the text, how do you guys see the tension between the spirit of the interpreter Sukkot, trajectory happy, and the spirit of our leading last week and this week, trajectory very sad? Elias.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for putting me on the spot right away. The only thing that I know is that for about 10 days, we pray so far about the Shura. And we pray, you know, not only on behalf of the congregation, but just to look at ourselves and to see the areas we can improve and do better. And as soon as Yom Kippur is over, I go back to my colorful socks.
Yeah.
So the Shura is over. You know, it's like you go back to your old self, sir.
Yeah.
And anyway, so it didn't work that well. So I don't know. It's an interesting question you're bringing up with you, because I often think about that. Think about, you know, all these opportunities we give to our teens, and we see them growing up here at the synagogue with going to school, but mitzvahs and all the things that we try to not only. I mean, in my case, I not only try to be able for them to build love for Judaism, but build love with music, through music to Judaism. And not always works. But isn't it like we can apply that to all aspects of life, that we nurture, we teach, we educate, and then it's in their hands what they are doing with it?
Yeah, Michelle, okay.
So I just have a totally different read of this passage.
No, but you have to answer what he said.
No, I will. I'm getting to answer what he says through a really just a very different read. Because, yes, God says...
Well, before you do that, I don't interrupt. But can we just, for the people who haven't read it,
yes.
I'm just going to read the text.
Sure,
and
please.
Then we'll get you a different read. Okay?
Okay, can we read on to page 2 as well?
Yeah, because we're excellent.
I have no desire to exit. Okay? Okay? This is the text on which, for the basis of which, I did my hyper-Elias. The Lord said to Moses, "You are soon to lie with your fathers. This people will thereupon go astray after alien gods in their midst, in the land that they are about to enter. They will forsake me and break my covenant that I made with them. Then my anger will flare up against them, and I will abandon them and hide my countenance from them. They shall be ready prey, and many evils and troubles shall befall them. And they shall then say on that day, 'Surely it's because our God is not in our midst that these evils have befallen us. Yet I will keep my countenance hidden on their face because of all the evil that they have done in turning to other gods.' Therefore, write down this poem and teach it to the people of Israel. Put it in their mouths in order that this poem may be my witness against the people of Israel when I bring them into the land flowing with milk and honey that I promised on oath to their fathers. And they eat their fill and grow fat and turn to other gods and serve them, spurning me, breaking my covenant, and the many evils and troubles befall them, then this poem shall confront them as a witness, since it will never be lost in the mouth of their offspring. For I know what plans they are devising even now before I bring them into the land that I promised on oath. That day Moses wrote down this poem and taught it to the Israelites."
Okay.
That's the basis for the high poem, Michelle.
Okay, so my very different read from yours actually comes from verse 19 and verse 22, which is Moses, you know, if I was to try to imagine God here and put God into plain English, I mean, Moses, we've got a problem. The people who we are encountering, it's a pattern. I mean, talk about Yom Kippur coming through this text. They're going to keep doing this again and again and again. We haven't solved this together once and done. But Moses, write down this poem. Because guess what? These people are going to keep struggling forever with faith. And they're going to keep struggling forever to get to a place of doing the right thing. And when they get there, they're going to need you. And yes, it's true, you're going to die, and you're not going to be here. So we need your living legacy. We need your words. We need this Torah. And when they get there, they're going to turn to the illumination that this moment has put into their heart, and they're going to see they've done this before. It's been bad before. It's been hard before. They got through it then. They can get through it now.
Okay, Michelle. Kyron comes to you after Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur and says, Rabbi Robinson, I really like this year's sermon on the holiday. This year's sermon really kind of finally connected with me, right? But what they're kind of saying is that the last 23 years, not so much, right? I mean, this is a well-known hazard. It's the compliment with the left hand. Like, I really like this year. It's like, the first, you know, this happens every once in a while. Somebody's never given you a compliment, gives you a compliment. Like, this time, this sermon, the other 23 years, not so much. Okay, so here's what I want to say. Even with your generous read to God, what God is saying is, you know, Moses, you've been giving sermons in the book of Deuteronomy every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. I mean, you've just been giving, you're a sermon machine. And none of that worked. All your other 23 years worth of sermons basically failed. So try one last sermon, do it in a different mode, right? So how is that not a diss on the rest of Moses' life?
So it's not none of that worked. It's that there is really no such thing as a final work. It's constant work. And Moses was constantly doing it in his lifetime. And when Moses dies, God continues to need a partner, which comes in the form of our Torah that we have, to help us to continue to grow, to do the work constantly. It's not one and done.
Okay, yes. And then
I agree. Beautiful, beautiful. You're always so, so beautiful, the words you say. But for the people there, they have a limited time on earth. So there is an end. Either they follow the traditions or not. They follow, you know, God's teachings or not. So you are looking at more universally what happens with humankind.
I mean, Michelle, I have one last thing and then I got to get to Dan. Michelle, you, Annalisa, of course, yes. You're just what we love about you, the Dominican, is you're always optimistic, you always look at the glass half full or even one tenth full. But it's hard to deny that God says they're really going to screw it up and I'm going to be so angry at them. They're going to get exiled and it's all going to end badly. Right, so you do a poem, but it's going to end badly. So it's hard. And by the way, Moses, you are soon to lie with your father. So he's kind of, instead of saying to him what you have said to countless families, everything's going to be good, everything's going to go well, you can be at peace, your work is done, be at peace. He's saying to Moses, your work is not done. Everything you stood for failed. It didn't take. They're going to be exiled because they can't listen to you. And have a good death.
Yeah, I mean, I personally actually find that comforting because the real world, because the real world actually doesn't work that way. None of us finish all of the work that we have to do. The basic facts of life would prove to anyone on their deathbed that they may have done their best. They may have given as much as they can, but we do a vidui on the deathbed. We actually ask people to think about the things that were not done, that were not accomplished, and actually try to hand that to the next generation. And the idea that we're part of a bigger universal trend, that it's not just about my life. If I'm among the 400 years of generations that die in Egypt, I know that somebody's going to get there, that something that I have transmitted is going to move forward. And to me, I find that really comforting, and I hope Moses did too.
So to sum this up, and then Dan, you're up. What you're saying, Michelle, is this is about the inevitability and the universality of unfinished work. That everybody dies with unfinished work. Everybody lives, hopefully, with aspirations for their contribution to a better world. And everybody dies in the middle of their story. Everybody dies in the middle of their story, even if they're 87, even if they're 94, even if they're 120, they're in the middle of their story. And this is about the inevitability, the universality of unfinished work. And so this is actually a compassionate teaching, because it says that if Moses could have unfinished work, so can we. You're so good, Michelle. Dan.
I guess I'm kind of with Michelle a little bit. I want to go back to what Elias began with. you know, the fact that we don't know the impact that, that what we do is 20 years from now with our B'nai Mitzvah, for example. But every, you know, every once in a while you run across someone, and you'll see this in where you've been doing this for many years, you run into someone who actually says, you know, it seemed like I was so disconnected when I was having my Bar Mitzvah, but now that I'm an adult and I'm married with my first kid, I understand, now I understand what you were trying to do, and that really, and what you did really connected with me. So that happens, that's a little bit of the positive thing, like that Michelle was saying. But then, of course, you know, like Tevye, on the other hand, you know, Moses is I think Wes, you also read, Moses is saying, Moses is being told by God, you know, instead of saying, nice job, but he just says, not good job. You know, you try, you know, we don't want to say on a deathbed, if we can get to that point, we tried our best and we hoped we had an impact. And God's saying to Moses, you know, you tried your best, but you had no impact. And, you know, for the past year, your entire life has been unimpactful. And none of us wants to hear that. And what you're saying, what the text says is very clear.
That's how I read it. I read it as saying, if I were in Moses' shoes, I would hate to give this oracle for that. Because it just feels so sobering. Lisa, what's your read on this one?
I'm sorry. I'm with the majority here. I think my read of the hypo would be slightly different, would be, you know, the beginning's really the same, but then, you know, Elias, you're going to go, these kids are going to go to college, they're not even going to go to Hillel, they're not going to really prioritize and making Judaism central to their life, but, you know, I think what you can do is record some things, and, you know, at some point they're going to stumble upon it on the internet, and it's going to wake them up, and who knows, at that point you might have the potential to wake them back into this, and so, I don't see it as hopeless. I also don't necessarily see it as a critique of most. I mean, if anything, and this is something we've talked about, I think that the Moses' fatal flaw is he makes everything all about him. And he never figures out how to empower the community, and he never figures out, you know, that the whole Korach rebellion, and he just lets God swallow them up in the earth when these people rise up and say, I want to have a relationship with God. I want to be somebody who's going to be able to understand and interpret tradition. I want to be in the inner tent. He's like, nope, I am the only person that gets to see God. And so the consequence of that, the consequence of being exclusive, means that he's also kept exclusive, that when that ultimate dream comes to be, he's kept out of the tent and swallowed up by the earth.
Let me just ask one last question about Ha'azinu. I take a last comment, and one last question about Ha'azinu, which is our reading today, based on what we just read. And then we'll pivot to our second text, Elias.
No, you opened a can for me of possibilities. You get, you know, your sermon was really inspirational today. I got the top ones. You can never surpass these ones. So, you know, you sounded great today.
Right.
Like, okay, that's one thing. Then 3 hours of singing, oh, canto, David sounded great. But nothing can top this one, the best I ever heard. 3 hours. Lying on the floor, going for a lane, or singing Eric Clapton, singing anything you want. Cantor, you need a haircut. Anyway.
Okay. Thank you for that.
And that's what you see in God's message to Moses.
Yeah. So I wanted to just do one last question on this, which is, now maybe it's a sui generis read, but it's a real question that goes to the heart of what God says there. It says, therefore, write down this poem and teach it to the people of Israel. Put it in their mouths in order that this poem may be my witness against the people of Israel. Here's my question. Prose is much more accessible than poetry for most people. So Moses is given very clear and simple prose sermons with a message. It couldn't be simpler, and we all know well in the teaching business, the best sermon is the simple sermon. The simple sermon is the best sermon. Clear, easy, simple, kiss, keep it simple, stupid, that's the best sermon, right? And Moses' sermon, repeated many times, is, if you do the mitzvot, your life will be good, you'll stay in Israel. If you don't do the mitzvot, your life will be bad, you'll be kicked out of Israel. An alternative version, that's day one of Rosh Hashanah, day two. If you do the mitzvot, your life will be good, that's choose life. If you don't do the mitzvot, your life will be bad, that's death. Those are the sermons. Simple, clear, just not followed, okay? And the corrective to that is this recondite, opaque, abstruse, inaccessible poem. You have to be a professor of literature at Hebrew University, born and raised in Israel for 11 generations, to even begin to understand, right? But if you're just like an average person, who gets poetry? Right? So if you don't get the simple sermons in prose, how would anyone get Ha'azir?
So I think it's really important because two things. One, most of the sermon doesn't work. Like, we all know it's not true. I mean, like, I'm sort of laughing this year, and I'm sure this is the old poetry, but I was just saying with Michelle yesterday, like, last year I was like, okay, Solomon, we're going to really do Sukkot. And last year Sukkot was late. It was very cold. Like, I was insistent we had to sleep in the sukkah. We slept in the sukkah. It was like 30 degrees. We'd wake up and we had ice in our eyebrows and in our eyelashes, and we were so cold. And I was like, but we're going to do Sukkot, and then God's going to answer our prayers. I'm like, maybe God's going to answer our prayers this year, but it didn't work last year. And that's, I think, the bottom line of Moses' Torah, which is God can say all these things, and God can promise the people all these things, but it's not true. And actually, a poem has the potential to be inscrutable. A poem allows for mystery. A poem allows for people to have the idea that we don't understand how the world works entirely. And the other truth about learning is that when we learn much better from our own wisdom than we do from other people telling us what to do. So, like, if you're trying to get a child to do something and you really want to do them,
can you tell me the answer to that one? Because yes. That would be super helpful. Please. That will go viral. You're going to tell parents how to get their kids to do what they want. Go. You're on.
So, I feel like you see a child doing something that you don't want them to do, you say, don't do that. That's the easiest way to make sure they continue to do that. But if you tell a child a story often, and of another child in a similar experience with a different outcome, a struggle story, then you have the potential for them to think of it on their own, and they'll respond like, oh, I have this new idea for how I could change my behavior. And it wasn't that you told them, but they intuitively got it. And I think that's way more powerful. I think that's what God's trying to get Moses to do for the people.
So
I really like that.
Beautiful. So. Will you come to my house, please? No, I mean, Wes, this is a word that you really like. The word for poem here that's used is Shira.
I love that word. Yeah. Favorite word in the world.
And what does Shira mean?
Yeah. Sure means you do what she says.
Yes.
That's what
I mean.
Yes, dear.
Do the laundry, honey.
Sure, I mean, the English translation.
Do the laundry, honey.
Yes, dear. How high, dear?
Take out the sun.
Dear God. It works.
Shira is, of course, also a song, right?
Yeah.
And I had thought that I would hear from you that there's something about music and there's something about rhyme, right, that goes to places where our rational mind doesn't hit, right? And this often happens. We were doing this at Yom Kippur services, where you did Shema Kolenu, right? It's like, Shema Kolenu, just tear out your heart. God, please listen to me.
And you did it like a dance song. It's like a jazz. I wanted to go dancing with Shira when I heard your Shema Kolenu. We're going to die, please. Don't cast us off in all days. Don't cast us off all days. And it was just a boppity bop.
Yes. And so there's something that transcends the power of the words themselves, that professor of Hebrew literature that has to understand each and every nuance of that word. There's something in our soul that understands song at a deeper level, whether we understand the wording and the message or we don't.
Yes, I agree with that. Can I say something?
Yes.
Are you done, my friend? Okay, no, I'm not going to say the same thing. So, you know, I always struggled for years, for my whole career, I struggled with Azino. You know, it's like I'm teaching students and they ask me, Kanto, what does it mean? I have no idea. Go and ask the rabbis.
You're not the Jerusalem
right.
Generation.
Go and ask the rabbis. Don't bother me with that. So, but, you know, interesting enough, talking about that, we have a beloved family here, at least beloved by me, most of Lasky, they're Argentinians, and they belong here to Temple Manu. 3.5 years ago, Eitan, the oldest boy, was Bar Mitzvah. And the parsha was Azino. And Gustavo, the father, comes and says, Elias, I want to, not like that in Spanish, he said to me, Elias. Anyways, I want to learn the Torah portion. And I taught him. He still remembers the Torah portion. Actually, 2 months ago was Naomi's Bat Mitzvah, and he said, can I do the one I know from Azino? because I know it by heart. So the power of connecting music with text is actually...
Exactly.
I don't know what it means, but it's good. I mean, I would
ask
you
that. And that's
something
you can carry with you. And so Ha'azinu gets carried with us generation to generation to generation. And these words can stick.
Yeah. So I'm on the same page with everybody. I mean, you know, the word, when something connects, it clicks with you, we use the word resonate, which means that your entire body is vibrating with that sound. And the Hasidic masters, they taught us that the most powerful thing is a nigun. You don't need words. And it's the melody. But here you have, you know, this poetry, and the poetry with the rhythm and just the way it's chanted and the way it sounds, again, it just resonates with us. And as I think Michelle or Lisa said, that it's the mystery, right? It doesn't, you don't know exactly what it's saying, but you know that it's speaking to your heart. And so whether you're 11th, you know, generation of a scholar, which is great to have, by the way, to really understand the nuance of the poetry, you know, think about the things that that in show when people want to sing along, it's Oz, it's Yemosha, you know, the different poems that we have in the Torah are just the ones that people know the best.
Well, let me end this in a Jewish way with a Dvar Torah quoting Jonathan Sachs with a question. Which is Jonathan Sachs' take on Ha'azinu in his last beautiful book, Black Kings and Israel Torah, is that all the prose didn't work because it spoke to the mind. And it was basically telling people to do stuff, and the people, like our children, don't like to be told what to do. And so Jonathan Sachs' argument is that Moses ends by appealing to the heart, and not to the mind, not to the rational, but to the emotional. And Jonathan Sachs says at the end, that if you want to get somebody, trying to persuade somebody, speak to their heart, not to their mind. That the heart is in control. Speak to their emotions. And I love all that, obviously. My problem is, how do you speak to your heart if it's opaque poetry that you don't understand? And I just want to end with a question on Aliza, which is, as between mystery and lucidity, as between mystery and clarity, I'll pick clarity and lucidity 100% of the time. I like to know what I'm dealing with, and move me emotionally by stuff I understand. Don't move me with, I mean, the logical sense of what you're saying is that we could preach in Aramaic, because that would be a mystery to everybody. But we want communication is about being understood. So I'll just end with a comment that I never understand Ha'azinu, because I don't understand Ha'azinu, I don't know some poetry, so I don't get how it speaks to the heart if you don't understand it. But I love all your takes. Now I want to turn to the second text, which is, I want to read this. I'll just read it for itself. And Aliza, I want to come to you with this as a framing question. You love the 13 divine attributes. You know, we've just been doing Rosh Hashanah and Kippur together, and you just go off on the 13 attributes, and you come up with, you know.
Do I really love them? I made you sing them all
a lot. Yes, and not only did you make us sing it in Hebrew. And when I suggested, we're trying to cut, right? Because, you know, we went from a 3-hour and 45-minute service to a 2-hour service. So I once did the heretical thing on the beam of saying to Aliza, can we cut the 48th rendition of 13 attributes?
No.
Cut anything else. Just don't cut the 13 attributes.
Yes.
Okay? And plus, I'm going to sing it in English, too.
I stand by that decision.
Okay? Now, here's my question. This is the end of the Torah. My question is this the God of mercy as embodied by the 13 attributes? So here we go. That very day, the Lord spoke to Moses, ascend these heights of Abarim to Mount Nebo, which is in the land of Moab, facing Jericho, and view the land of Canaan, which I am giving the Israelites as their holding. You shall die on the mountain that you are about to ascend, and shall be gathered to your kin as your brother Aaron died on Mount Hor and was gathered to his kin. For you both broke faith with me among the Israelite people at the waters of Meribat Kadesh in the wilderness of Zin, by failing to uphold my sanctity among the Israelite people. You may view the land from a distance, but you shall not enter it, the land that I am giving to the Israelite people.
It's kind of like Nechamocha. And I'll say the reason is because when you say Nechamocha, it's who is like you. And there's a way of being like, who is like you? Like, who is like you? Like, is there anyone like you? Like, oh my God, who is like you? You are amazing. And that's how I experienced the 13 attributes, that it's saying, God, we want you to be this compassionate, patient, loving, supportive God. Please be that God. Give us that. It's not a guarantee. You like us struggle with your anger. You like us struggle to always do the right things. And we really hope you'll be compassionate with us.
Well, actually, I just want to ask, this portion, you know, is very moving in that, to kind of channel Michelle's spirit on the first text, it says not only that, you know, unfinished work is inevitable, universal, but unfinished, like, life aspirations, like deeply held convictions and goals that you have, you know, everybody's going to die on the wrong side of the river Jordan. It'll happen to Moses. It will happen to you. There's a certain comfort to that, okay? I guess my question, though, is, so this is not God being a meanie pie. This is human condition. Here's my question. God saying to Moses, get to the top of the mountain and look at the river you can't cross and look at the land you can't enter. Is that a compassionate God?
Yeah, so the fact that there are limits in this world, the fact that there are boundaries, is not a punishment. It's actually just the truth. And God actually relents. I mean, the initial reality was going to be that Moses died without even seeing it. And Moses prays and says, God, please, 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 I want to see. And God relents. But God is a good parent, and God is a good God. And God doesn't say, like, okay, well, just because you really want that extra sugar after dinner means I'll just give it to you. No, God's like, no, here's a limit. You know what? I'm willing to consider this. Here's the way I'm willing to go. You can look at it. You can see where they're going. But here's the limit. I'm sorry. This is the end of your life.
Again?
It's also not inconsistent. You know, the 15 attributes, the way it's done in the Siddur versus the text, right? It's an akeh lo yin akeh. You know, God's... So we say God is forgiving and all, but it says that God does not forgive to the tenth generation. That's really the full text in the Torah. So God is not being inconsistent here. We're being inconsistent in the way we're praying, in a certain way. And I think that Elise is right, that this is a compassionate God, because God is being consistent. But also, I think there's a certain hope that Moses has. You know, God has just told Moses, the people are going to screw up, but here's this beautiful land, and, you know, maybe there's a bit of hope there.
I don't want to go first. Before the wall, I think. So, I have a different perspective here, because one way of looking at this is with human eyes. And with human eyes, we can say that God is not that all good, you know? He's punishing Moses, and he's holding the grudge. He's holding the grudge for something that Moses did before. So, Micha Mocha Ba'elim Adonai could be seen as the other one, like, who is like you, God? We are all like you, because we all do bad stuff, and you did bad stuff. So that's another view. Now, a couple of little things that I love about this. The word for ascend is Aleh. And it has a trope called Bazer, that is kind of like a fork, right? So in this case, it's perfect. It never been applied a trope better than to this word. The trope is pa 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 pa. So it's like pa 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 pa, like the mountain. In this case, it should have been go up and die, and you never come down because you died. Anyway. But it's so beautiful that we have that trope placed in that word.
Say more. It sounds like a profound point, but I didn't quite get it. Say that again.
No, the point is that Aleh,
yeah,
means ascend.
How would it sound when you do it with the chanting, with the cantillation?
Aleh. So going up the mountain and coming down, and he's not coming down. He died.
I think part of it, what I'm hearing you say, Elias, is that the music goes up and down as if you're crossing the river versus but it actually doesn't get to cross. But you hear it audibly as if he's landed in the land, but we know cognitively he didn't make it. Yeah.
And what's the point of that dissonance now? That the music goes up and down, but the text says
that life is complicated, human beings are complicated, God is complicated.
This is such a profound point, Elias. Thank you so much for it, because you know, you really would expect if you're going to go up and that's the end. You're done. And there are short marks.
Is there a note that would just go up and say, what's that?
Absolutely.
Talitha Gadola?
Kadma.
We're like getting deep into grammar.
Anyway,
you would
okay,
have
right.
Point
point
there.
It's a beautiful, it's a beautiful midrash on that trope, which really punches something I think is so important about this moment, which picks up on a little of what Aliza was saying as well. You know, anybody who has done a little bit of a reading in modern parenting book knows that you can try to punish children. And when you try to punish children, you know, I mean, I can't even tell you how many timeouts I did with my children and how absolutely useless all of them were, you know, sit in that chair. We had the timeout chair. It is gathering dust, right, for a long, long time. But there's a parenting philosophy of natural consequences, right? That when your child does something, you don't have to come in and punish, because fundamentally when they do the wrong thing, often, not always, but often there's a natural consequence on something that they will miss out on. And it feels like in this moment, God is pointing out the natural consequence. By the way, Moses, you know, that thing, you and Aaron lost your temper, you didn't do the right thing at the right time, and there's a natural consequence to that, right? You don't get to see everything fulfilled. But I'm not going to stop there. And that's the beauty of this trope mark that you bring, because you're going to have to experience your natural consequence. But that's not the end of your story. And all of us, at least as a parent myself, and thank you, Aliza, for bringing that metaphor, as a parent myself, I never want my child to feel like, however bad their natural consequences, that they're stuck there. I want them to see that there's always something past that. And I think that's what God gives Moses. He gives him a vision that yes, you're not going to get there, but there is something past your worst moment.
So I love how all the four of you just left God and are prepared to give God a break. I just want to say for the record, I'm not with this God. And I find this God to be an abusive God. And I would not want this God as a father. I would not want this God as a mother. Would not want this God as a spouse or as a child. Don't like this God. Because here's why I don't like this God. This is the end of Moses' life. Moses has spent 40 years. He basically abandons his wife. He basically doesn't really have a relationship with his kids. He is a happy shepherd in Midian. He gives all this up to do God's work for 40 years. Okay? I think God commits the unforgivable sin. And this is a sin that, you know, it's a whole separate conversation, but especially is ascendant in this day of social media. God commits the sin of judging somebody on their worst moment. So here is at the end of Moses' life. And what does God pick? Moses' worst moment. Verse 51. So you broke faith with me among the Israelite people at the waters of Meribah that we will have to sin. Moses hits the rock. He's still talking to the rock. And kind of thing. And I just feel like I don't want that guy. I don't want anybody in the world to be judging me on the basis of my worst moment. And I think this is really bad of God to do that. So how do you, and would you want to be in dialogue with somebody who they look at the canvas of 40 years of your life, all the nights you stayed up working, all the early mornings, all the times you put yourself second, third, or fourth, all the time you gave blood, sweat, and tears, all the time you gave heart and soul, all the time you really cared, all the time you really invested. And one moment in 40 years, you lost it. And you had a meltdown. And after 40 years, I'm going to look at your canvas and I'm going to say, oh, I'm going to focus on the one time you lost it, not on the 40 years. I just think that is unacceptable. I don't want that guy.
Can I say something? So, for the record, it's not 4-1. It's 2-3, because what I said before, I agree with you.
Oh, sure.
That God, you know, could be seen as bad, not always as good. And interesting topic you're bringing up, because how many times in history we've seen people who have in different professions wonderful careers, and they screw up one thing, and they are gone.
You are judged by your final hour, not by your finest hour. That's Andy Stanley.
Right, but how do you apply that you don't want anybody to judge you for your worst day? Because many of those people who ruin their lives and their careers are just for the bad day. So how do you apply that to them?
I mean, to me, I actually see that fact that we really do grapple with in our world today, very much so. I actually see God's response as very embracing in that moment.
God can do no wrong with
really, because God can do wrong, and I can hold God accountable for many pieces of the Torah, as in our conversation on for the holiday. God can be a vengeful God. I mean, I'm not trying to sugarcoat God, but I do feel like here in that moment when you're fully broken, when that piece of your past has caught up with you, and you're not going any farther, God gives Moses a kiss in that moment. I mean, God gives Moses a vision of a possibility of something that's beyond that worst moment. And to me, that completely provides a model of what we can all do for each other when we're at that worst moment, when we have those feelings of failure that we all have at some point. None of your sermons suck, right? We can still say, yeah, but those sermons are going to be heard by somebody someday.
Okay, Michelle, but you've been, officiating at high holiday services for 22 years. And, part of that is to carry your friends, your time. Okay? This is like 40 Yom Kippurs ago, or 22 Yom Kippurs ago, or whenever this thing was. After all those Yom Kippurs, God is still bringing it up. Like, Yom Kippur didn't happen. I just think
Moses never apologized.
Huh?
Moses never apologized. I mean, I think it's actually okay that there are some things in our world, like, if you're a public officer and you siphon funds from, and use it inappropriately, it's okay to say, like, actually, we're not going to have you be a public officer again. We don't trust you with our money. If you're a teacher and you abuse students, it's okay to say, you know what, we're not going to let you teach again. It's not appropriate. And I think that's not a bad thing. That's actually, there's a level at which actions have consequences. They have to have consequences. And Moses, he could have gone through. He could have worked it through with God. He could have, but he didn't. He was just angry. And you know what? He let himself get angry. He got bought into God's vision, and he abandoned his people. He abandoned his family. He abandoned his own goals, his own dreams, and he's bitter about it. But that's not on God. That's on him. Ultimately, God asked him to get the people out of Egypt. God did not ask him for 4 years. God asked him for one action, get the people out of Egypt, and he took it upon himself to keep going.
Okay, guys.
God certainly didn't ask him to abandon his family in doing so, right? We each actually approach the challenges of our lives with the tools that we bring. And Moses sometimes didn't hear the lesson that he was actually the mouthpiece of God for.
So I want to end our conversation by asking you, just to zoom out, we have these two texts, your work is unfinished text, and you're not going to cross the river Jordan into the land text. And my question is, what's the message? We've just finish the season of judgment. What is the resonance of these two texts about Moses? Your life work is undone because the people are going to stray, and because you had your worst moment, you're not going to cross into the land. What's the resonance of this for us in just a word, Elisa?
Can I start by joking a little bit so they can bring a more serious answer to that? Because you will want to end on a positive note.
Yes, Elisa.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So, I did a shoe. I said I should not wear these socks anymore. I should not do jokes in Talmud, but then I'm back to the old ways. So I never knew, Elisa, and you are familiar with this, that Rodgers and Hammerstein wrote this song for Moses. Climb every mountain, search high and low. Find a nice, cozy place. That's where you will die. That's the original lyrics, not just joking. Anyways, but Moses, he has this ability of climbing back and forth mountains. Mount Sinai, go back and forth twice, and then Mount Arnebo, go back and forth all the time. So that's my answer.
Thank you, Elisa.
Elias, can I just jump in and say that I feel like it's unfair, the whole thought competition you have going on, because Elisa and I can never participate.
You have skirts.
Okay. Okay.
You're doing well with the skirt.
Stock was 2 Yom Kippurs ago. Elisa.
Humility.
Humility. Humility. Dan?
actually hard. I think in I don't know, I really don't have an answer. I think in God is just for us. It's all about hope. I think there's even in our worst moments, and even being judged in our worst moments, we still have hope coming from Yom Kippur. I just think I hope. That's all I can say.
But unfinished does not mean failure.
So I would just say that I have a very personal connection to Jesus because, you know, I was a junior in college when I lost my dad, and he died in December, and I came back and to exams, which was really tough in its own right. Of course, I missed so many weeks of school because I was in the hospital with my dad, and I came back, and it just felt like very overwhelming. My dad died at 64, and I remember when I felt really low, I read these passages from Deuteronomy about Moses was dying on the wrong side of the Jordan, and just I received them as actually a compassionate message that if Moses died on the wrong side of the Jordan, it must be part of the human condition, so do we all. So, Elisa, could you close out our class by singing the 13 attributes of Jesus?
Adonai, Adonai, compassion and tenderness, patience, forbearance, kindness, awareness, making love from its grave, lifting guilt and mistakes, and making us free.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Now we're going to cross the to the central.